It didn't feel to me like it was like street food, right, basically. And that was very cool. By the way, Sucio Talk in Houston, Texas, sitting here with Chef Justin Yu. How you doing, Chef?
Doing well. How are you? Thanks for having me.
Fucking right. Are we? We're right next to where? Theodore Rex?
Yeah,
correct?
So we're sitting in the little private dining room that we have nice, the only nice hum of a freezer that we keep our proteins in. So.
Oh, that's all good. That's all good.
But we use it
as a you got Adele on record?
We got Adele on record. We got Solange. We got a nice eclectic mix over there. It's anything from Guardians of the Galaxy soundtrack to like Beyonce to like...
do you guys just play the whole soundtrack?
So the private dining room is it's interesting. We call it our auxiliary art space. I thought it was funny because it shortens to Oxart. And Oxart was our original restaurant. So this is actually has all of our old Oxart furniture in it. And so people were actually, so we played everything off of records over at, originally over at Oxart.
Uh-huh.
And so everybody can make their own playlists. You know, we just have them set it up and then we play it throughout the meal. But this is kind of used as our PDR, as our kind of private room.
Got you.
It's right next door to the restaurant.
Yeah. How's it been booking that through COVID?
COVID has been interesting. This has fortunately been a really, a really exciting thing to actually have had. We used to use this as our waiting area. So we now just book it as an actual dining area.
Yeah.
And especially for people who were maybe a little bit more nervous about the COVID situation, obviously it was still a very serious thing.
Yeah.
That they had the option to have their own private room. So that was a blessing for us and something we kind of just stumbled into, but something that has helped us out a lot, at least just to maintain the salaries of our employees that work off of tips, and, you know, keep business up. It was one of those things that just happened to work out for us when everything else was not working out well. So,
all right. So before we get into your whole story, I just want to ask you, did you envision having this restaurant empire that you now have?
I did not. Yeah, no. I mean, well, it's weird. I have people that talk to me, like knew me younger, they always knew that I wanted multiple restaurants.
Gotcha.
As I was cooking throughout my kind of the younger part of my career, I always thought I would be like kind of chained to the stove to a single restaurant.
Mm-hmm.
And as I was cooking my way through Oxart, it kind of made it apparent to me that that's not what I wanted. I liked overseeing as opposed to being the guy who
is
making it every single day.
Heard that. Yeah. I mean, you can kind of get embittered.
You can get a little embittered.
Yeah.
It's, it's tough on your body, too. Our restaurant is 900 square feet. So all that dipping, ducking, and diving, like, you know, all your joints if you're not stretching every single night. You know, I was 30 some odd when I closed Oxart, and so I haven't been working the day to day since then.
Heard that.
On any singular restaurant, and, it definitely helps my health and longevity.
Yeah.
And then it helps me kind of support people
100%
on a day-to-day basis. So,
yeah, because when I met your... What is your chef's name?
My chef's name is Caitlin Steets. It's weird. She's actually going to be moved to executive chef after the new year. So.
Oh, no way.
So,
very
yes,
cool.
She's
congratulations.
CDC right now. Yeah, she's fantastic.
Awesome.
Yeah.
I'll come back and talk to her for sure. But, you know, we're going to take it all the way back. Justin, where were you born?
I was born in Houston, Texas. I grew up in the Memorial area, which is a little bit more of an affluent area, but in the smallest house.
Yeah.
My parents are Cantonese Chinese, so kind of grew up in Houston, very focused on not, like, it's something like I've always wanted to cook, but they didn't really want to let me cook.
Heard that.
But I had aunts that owned a restaurant in Southern California, always loved restaurants and dining. I always was the fat kid, so I always love food. And so I feel as if a lot of chefs kind of end up that way.
Yeah, 100%.
I mean, so some people kind of fall into it because it's like something they ended up being good at.
Uh-huh.
I've never wanted to do anything else in my life. So
got you. Yeah. Heard that. So were you working in the family restaurants when you were younger?
So that was my first. Yeah, we visited every single summer.
Heard.
My first job was washing toilets and bussing tables.
Mm-hmm.
And I did that, you know, for one summer, knew that I wanted to do it. And then when I came back to Houston, when I was in high school, I was like, I wanted to get a summer job, got a couple restaurant jobs. And then finally my dad was like, okay, well, I know you want to do like kind of higher end dining. Cause I think that was always kind of, I've always verbalized that. And he was like, I'll show you. like, I'm going to put you in my friend's nice restaurant, and he's going to run you over.
Okay.
And so I did that, and so but at the end of the first day, his friend, like, went back to him and was like, hey, you need to tell him to, like, sit down during staff meal. He won't sit down. He won't do anything.
Yeah.
So, like, I wouldn't take a break.
Exactly.
So my parents kind of got on board. I think they realized that it was something that
you're passionate about.
Passionate about. It was something that I was very, it was a very one-track mind. I would say I'm extremely lucky in that way. A lot of people kind of meander their way into this career.
100%.
It's something that I've known that I've wanted for my entire life. So
yeah. I've been told by friends that don't know exactly what they want, like, oh, you're so lucky. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But then again, as a chef, when you're busting your ass after, you know, the first 5 years, you're like, no, you're lucky, motherfucker. Like, right. You know what I mean?
Well, there's times that I feel as if I missed, like, little things, like, you know, goofing off in school because I always worked. So there's good and bad with it, you know. Like, I, you know, sometimes I wish I had different disciplines that I think that I've actually kind of gained as I've loosened my grip on the kitchen over the years. Like things like design, like graphic design, you know, furniture design, I always really enjoyed, but never really had a place for it. And so learning more about that's always been fun.
Very cool. Very cool. So this restaurant that you worked at, the Finer Dining Place, what was it called? Who was the chef?
So it was one of the first kind of like progressive Japanese restaurants in Houston. It's called Azuma. It's still there. It's on Kirby. And the chef's name was Ray. And it was one of those places where it's like sushi was still a very relatively new thing in Houston, or at least. And then so like something like mixing kipi mayo and sriracha would blew my mind.
And so
that was those kind of things that we did. Eventually, they allowed me to, like, kind of clean the fish, make the rice.
Yeah.
Do all those things that should take a really long time. You know, did that for a summer. Took another job in, like, a large company that has multiple units. A place, like, if you live in Houston, the Pappas family is super, super great. They have great restaurants. I worked at a place called Papa Do's, or Papa Do. No apostrophe S at the end. Papa Do. And it was a machine. There was 2 hour waits every single night.
Yeah.
I worked the fry station. I worked the station where all you had to do, or your goal was to make sure no table did not have bread that was warm. And then you made baked potatoes. It's called bread and potato station.
Got you.
So that was the opening station. Yeah.
That's a lovely station right there. It's a lot better than the oyster dessert station.
That is. Yeah. Not getting oyster liquor in the desserts.
Yeah.
In
your
cakes. Tough. Yeah.
That's gross. So how long did you last there? Or how old were you when you started there?
When I started there, I was probably about 15. So
got you. Yeah. So did you work there through high school?
The last couple years of high school, and then throughout summer before culinary school, and then I went to culinary school right after high school.
Got you. Yeah. Where did you? How did you make the choice? And which culinary school did you go to?
I went to CIA in Hyde Park. Okay. I guess they had the other campuses, but they didn't have full programs at the time.
Understood.
I made that choice pretty early. I think freshman year of high school, I had the choice of the chance to go to a private school, and I told my parents, I was like, you're going to be wasting your money on me going to a private school here in Houston. I stayed in the public school. Plus, also my friends were all there. Mm-hmm. And like, because I want to go to culinary school. And they're like, no, are you sure you want to go to culinary school? And I'm like, 100%, I want to go to culinary school. So, knew I wanted to go there, found CIA and went to go check it out before my senior year. Knew that's where I wanted to be. Ended up there after senior year of high school. School-wise, did that for a couple years. Got an associate's degree and then came back down to Houston to get my bachelor's at University of Houston, which I didn't know at the time until I started kind of researching when I decided not to do my bachelor's at CIA, that University of Houston had like a really great hotel restaurant management school. And then did that and worked my way through different kitchens in Houston after that. And then did my traveling after that. And kind of that did probably about 4 or 5 years of traveling before I came back to Houston to open up the restaurant.
Holy fuck.
Yeah.
All right. So culinary school, what was your internship?
Internship, I worked. So technically, I was supposed to be at Spring Restaurant in Chicago.
Yeah.
They were opening up a restaurant called Green Zebra. That was open for probably 10 or 12 years. Spring, the chef's name is Sean McClain. He owns a couple restaurants in Vegas now and in Detroit. Like, totally, like, cut my teeth. Like, just, like, had no idea that, like, fennel could go into ice cream, something like that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Right? And so that was like a very, very eye opening for me. And then ended up going to Green Zebra, which was Chicago's like kind of first progressive vegetarian restaurant. Heard. They always had one fish and one chicken on the menu.
Yeah,
but
no red meat whatsoever.
No red meat. It was always 20 menu items, and then they had that one fish, one chicken.
Heard.
But the first time that I really thought that a vegetable could carry a dish. But again, it was just like, you know, for me, this was in the early 2000s. Really wanted to, you know, like, very lucky that I ended up in Chicago. Got to check out, like, Blackbird and Avec and all those places. And
yeah,
it definitely was in true. And kind of like that really kind of really fantastic time and place
over 100%.
In Chicago at the time. Yeah.
Damn. I bet the cook community there was...
It was really strong, and even better, I actually was one of the only people that had a car, and it was really stupid of me to have a car. I was a dumbass. I shouldn't have ever brought a car to Chicago. I ruined my car over there. I had it towed a couple times because it's like you had to pay attention to the signs.
Yeah.
You couldn't figure out, like, you know, like there's street cleaning one day, and I was just like, I lost so much money on that. But the cook community was really great, so I had the car, so we would, like, track down to Chinatown and eat, or go to Smart Bar or something like that.
Yeah.
But it was actually I remember sitting reading a magazine, finding out that Grant had left Trio, and by the time I think a couple months after I came back from externship and I was in culinary school, Alinea opened.
Okay.
So, but he left Trio during my time, and I was able to, when the first time I drove down to check out Spring to do my internship, it was my dad's birthday.
Yeah.
And I accidentally booked us a hotel room up in Evanston, and I'd just seen this whole like Food Network show about Trio, about Grant doing this crazy food. And I was like, it's your birthday, like, let's go out to try something new. And my dad's this big, like, loves eating. People in Houston actually, like, love him way more than they love me.
Gotcha.
Because he's out at restaurants all the time. And, like, I was like, do you want to, like, I called and tried to make a reservation. He was like, do you want, like, the 8-course menu or the 25-course menu? I was like, Dad, do you want, like, the 8-course menu or the 25-course menu? He was like, 25-course menu.
Yeah.
And so I was really lucky in being able to, like, try food like that at a pretty young age.
Yeah, 100%. That's a very cool experience, man. I actually just went to Royster for the first time.
Oh, great.
And I walk in, and there Grant Atkins is fucking expediting.
Yeah.
And I'm like, what the fuck is he doing here? You know what I mean? I'm like, what? But the last time I saw him, we did 12 days together, and I got sent home that night. So I was like, I don't think I'm going to go up there.
No.
Talk to him. But when did you leave Chicago?
So I did my internship in Chicago.
Yeah.
Left. They offered me a position, but I needed to go back to school.
Heard.
So I left that in 2005. Finished school. Went back down to Houston. Cooked in Houston for probably about 3 or 4 years. Restaurant called 17. It was in a hotel that's down here.
Yep.
Met who turned out to be my mentor, Ryan Pera. He owns a restaurant now called Cultivara. It's really, really fantastic.
Okay.
Italian focus. Kind of just taught me, like, the...
What the fuck is that? My phone's going off.
No,
so let it subside.
These things happen.
It's all good.
That's how you know this is a real podcast.
That's right.
So, like, taught me kind of just the basics of cooking.
Yeah.
Taught me kind of, like, you know, how to act in a kitchen, how to stay humble, how to make sure you keep your head down and just keep on working.
Yeah.
Kind of gave me the nuts and bolts on how to continue to keep on working. Left Houston and went to Napa, actually. Actually, went to Chicago because my wife at the time went to pastry school up there.
Got you.
Worked at a Marcus Samuelson restaurant up there called Sea House.
Okay.
The chef actually was from Houston and is a friend of mine. He opened up a place called Palivar in Marfa now. And in Marfa, Texas. You should stop by Marfa. It's crazy.
I got
place.
A notebook that says Marfa on it, and that's the only thing it seems like a little touristy town, no?
It's a little touristy, but it's very artsy. It's got a lot going on for it. It's definitely kind of like one of those places where, like, the people with the wide brim hats like to go to.
Yeah, is it like the Savannah of Texas?
I would say it's Savannah-esque. It's kind of got that, like, Santa Fe, like, Aspen thing going for it, except it's kind of just West Texas, kind of, like, dusty.
Got you. Yeah. Okay. Heard
but
that.
But very artsy.
Yeah.
And so I worked in Chicago again. So that was my second stint up there. And then went to Napa. And then that's where...